evening, and welcome to this evening prayer service from the Diocese of Georgia. You'll find the bulletin linked here on Facebook and also on YouTube. Right now, let's take some time to center ourselves before we join together in worship. Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. O God, make speed to save us. O Lord, make haste to help us. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Alleluia."
Together the portion of Psalm 66 found in your bulletin. Bless our God, you peoples. Make the voice of his praise to be heard, who holds our souls in life and will not allow our feet to slip. For you, O God, have proved us. You have tried us just as silver is tried. You brought us into the snare. You laid heavy burdens upon our backs. You let enemies ride over our heads. We went through fire and water, but you brought us out into a place of refreshment. I will enter your house with burnt offerings and will pay you my vows, which I promised with my lips and spoke with my mouth when I was in trouble. I will offer you sacrifices of fat beasts with the smoke of rams. I will give you oxen and goats. Come and listen, all you who fear God, and I will tell you what he has done for me. I called out to him with my mouth, and his praise was on my tongue. If I had found evil in my heart, the Lord would not have heard me. But in truth, God has heard me. He has attended to the voice of my prayer. Blessed be God, who has not rejected my prayer, nor withheld his love from me. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
A reading from the Gospel of Luke. Once while Jesus was standing beside the lake of Gennesaret, and the crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of God, he saw two boats there at the shore of the lake. The fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little way from shore. Then he sat down and taught the crowds from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep water and let your nets down for a catch." Simon answered, "Master, we have worked all night long, but have caught nothing. Yet if you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done this, they caught so many fish that the nets were beginning to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." For he and all who were with him were amazed at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you will be catching people." When they had brought their boats to shore, they left everything and followed him. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let us read together the Magnificat. My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on his lowly servant. From this day all generations will call me blessed. The Almighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. He has mercy on those who fear him in every generation. He has shown the strength of his arm. He has scattered the proud in their conceit. He has cast down the mighty from their thrones, and he has lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has come to the help of his servant Israel, for he has remembered his promise of mercy, the promise he made to our fathers, to Abraham and his children forever. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. We might wish that Jesus would just tell us what he's up to when he shows up in our lives. Those first disciples might have wondered too that day when Jesus showed up to help them with their fishing. They had been at it all night and had come up empty, sort of like sermon writing sometimes. And Jesus came and said, "Give it another go." And so they put out into deep water and caught so many fish that the nets began to tear. At which point, they left their boats and nets and followed Jesus. It's a straightforward story of call, right? It is a story of call, of course, but of call with all the uncertainty that call entails. Being faithful is not for the faint of heart. But let's go back to the beginning. back to the story before all those fish, back to when Jesus appropriated Simon's boat as a teaching platform. Jesus was apparently pursued by so many people that social distancing became an issue, so he got into Simon's boat. He just got in and sat down, rather like it belonged to him, sort of like the rabbi's chair in the synagogue. And of course, we can see the problem with this right away. I mean, it's all well and good that God wants to be part of our lives, but in the workplace, we'd likely have something to say if Jesus put on our clothes, sat in our chair, and rummaged around in our desk for a pencil. And then, for Jesus to tell us how to do our work, as Jesus did with those fishermen. Take some kind of nerve to tell people who are bone tired to give it one more try. But doesn't God often do that? So they put out their nets once more and came up with 2 boatloads full of fish, which is a pretty clear sign of something. It would be helpful to have a miracle every now and then, every once in a blue moon, just to be sure we're on the right track, wouldn't it? And then Jesus said, "Well, that's enough of that. You've got what you've been working for. Now I want you to leave it all behind and come do something totally new, something you've never even thought of before." Little did they know that they were called to be servants, to give up being in charge of their own lives. And I wonder if they could have imagined when they woke up that morning that their lives were about to change forever. And we would laugh if it happened to us, except that it does happen all the time. And God is gracious enough and wise enough not to let us know what's going on, or we'd back out in a hurry. "Thanks, but no thanks. I'm fine with the way things are." Except with God, things are never fine just the way they are. It turns out that the thing we majored in college is not at all the thing we're now doing with our lives. Or we've gotten comfortable with our daily routine, and then we get laid off. Or a couple awaiting a child discovers that it will in fact be twins. Or the friend we plan to visit is suddenly admitted to the hospital. Or our long-awaited vacation is put on hold while a virus sweeps the world. The possibilities are endless. All the ways in which life doesn't go as we thought it would, and then God shows up. Shows up to show us another way, to plant a new thought in our heads, to beckon us to follow down a path we never saw before. You have heard it said that life is what happens while we are making other plans. But I say to you, God's call is what happens while we are making other plans. And in fact, this is God's call: that in the ordinary things we do from day to day can be heard the beckoning voice of God. Because for as long as people have been telling stories, we have been telling the stories of God's presence in the ordinary, in tending sheep and baking bread, in attending a wedding and catching fish. Messages from God are everywhere. So that earning a living, getting married, raising a family, making a home, are all just means and places where God may speak to us, may call us out of the ordinary into a life of extraordinary abundance, like a boat overflowing with fish. But it can be unsettling. Being faithful when everything changes is hard. Hearing God's voice challenges us to see our lives as less under our control and more about being vulnerable to those baptismal promises we made so long ago. We would like things to be laid out ahead of time, clear, and not too complicated, please. To this whole messy business that is life, Pastor Walter Wangren said this about being faithful. He said, "Faith is work. It is a struggle. You must struggle with all your heart. And on the way, God will ambush you." So whether the new day brings your consecration as a bishop or an old friend at the door, whether it brings a sick child or a new job, whether it brings a new love or an old letter from the past, it may just be that life is about to change and that God is in the change. Because God's abiding presence is the one constant in the ever-changing life of faith. So, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let us reaffirm our faith with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. That this evening may be holy, good, and peaceful, we entreat you, O Lord, that your holy angels may lead us in paths of peace and goodwill. We entreat you, O Lord, that we may be pardoned and forgiven for our sins and offenses. We entreat you, O Lord, that there may be peace to your church and to the whole world. We entreat you, O Lord, that we may depart this life in your faith and fear and not be condemned before the great judgment seat of Christ. We entreat you, O Lord, that we may be bound together by your Holy Spirit in the communion of Deaconess Anna Alexander and of all your saints, entrusting one another and all our life to Christ. We entreat you, O Lord. O Lord, our God, by your Son Jesus Christ, you called your apostles and you sent them forth to preach the gospel to the nations. We bless your holy name for your servant Augustine, first Archbishop of Canterbury, whose labors in propagating your church among the English people we commemorate today. And we pray that with all whom you call and send, they may do your will, bide your time, and see your glory. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. This hour we turn to you, O Lord, in full knowledge of our frailty, our vulnerability, and our great need as your mortal creatures. We cry to you as one human family, unsure of the path ahead, unequal to the unseen forces around us, frightened by sickness and death that seem all too real to us now. Stir up your strength and visit us, O Lord. Be our shield and our rock and hiding place. Guide our leaders, our scientists, our nurses and doctors. Give them wisdom and fill their hearts with courage and determination. Make even this hour, O Lord, a season of blessing for us, that in fear we might find that you are mighty to save, and in illness or death we find the cross to be none other than the way of life. All this we ask in the name of the one who bore all our infirmities, even Jesus Christ, our risen and victorious Lord. Amen. O God, the life of all who live, the light of the faithful, the strength of those who labor,
and the repose of the dead, we thank you for the blessing of the day that is past,
and we humbly ask for your protection through the coming night. Bring us in safety to the morning hours, through him who died and rose again for us, your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. O God, you manifest in your servants the signs of your presence. Send forth upon us the spirit of love, that in companionship with one another, your abounding grace may increase among us. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
I will sing a song of praise, glory to thy name. hearts and voices we will raise glory to thy name. Jesus Christ, our Lord and King, came to earth to die, risen up in victory, we will glorify. I have seen the mountain tops, glory to thy name. Oceans, valleys, streams, and rocks, glory to thy name. Whole creation, join and sing the Father's praise. Let us give our lives to bring glory to thy name.
Let us pray together the general thanksgiving. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love and the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days, through Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to him from generation to generation in the church and in Christ Jesus forever and ever. Amen.